Dream of the Red Chamber, written by Cao Xueqin, narrated by Geoffrey Giuliano and the Icon Ensemble.
Icon Audio Arts.
A whole new world of classical literature celebrating the art of writing. There is a very special category reserved for what we generally agree to be stories and tomes which are a significant cut above, which elegantly describe the human condition, winding their way, word by word, chapter by chapter, through a delicate web of beautiful storytelling, as to remain untouched by even time. These are, by definition, the classics. When the synergy of truth, intelligence, and insightful description come together in a tale which moves one emotionally, inspires, and educates, these works are indeed classic, to be so in tune with one's literary powers as to create, often from imagination, a story full of emotion, tender at heart, overflowing with some illumined truth from deep inside, so that it can be universally recognized and relived by the eyewitness. That, too, is a classic. Together, we go far beyond the recommended reading list of the studious English language major to bring you what is the elemental soul of the art of the written word, so that you may, in your own way and time, enter into the story laid out before you, to be forever changed and just that much more enlightened. That, then, is the true power of classical literature, and our humble attempt at its presentation herein as an audiobook to remember. Welcome. The Dream of the Red Chamber, also known as the Story of the Stone, is one of the four great classical novels of China, and is considered the greatest of them all. Almost 40 main characters and some 500 minor characters tell the fortunes of the Chia family. The already wealthy family rises to new heights when Pao-yu's elder sister becomes an imperial consort. On her first visit home, a lush garden is built, where much of the rest of the story takes place. The decline of the Chia family begins with the death of the imperial consort, and when they fall into disfavor with the emperor, their mansions and the garden are all eventually destroyed.
Chapter 1. Zhen Shiying, in a vision, apprehends perception and spirituality. Jia Yucun, in the windy and dusty world, cherishes fond thoughts of a beautiful maiden. This is the opening section, this the first chapter. Subsequent to the visions of a dream which he had, on some previous occasion, experienced, the writer personally relates, he designedly concealed the true circumstances and borrowed the attributes of perception and spirituality to relate the story of the record of the stone. With this purpose, he made use of such designations as Zhen Shiying, truth under the garb of fiction, and the like. What are, however, the events recorded in this work? Who are the dramatis personae? Wearied with the drudgery experienced of late in the world, the author, speaking for himself, goes on to explain, with the lack of success which attended every single concern, I suddenly bethought myself of the womankind of past ages. Passing one by one under a minute scrutiny, I felt that in action and in law, one and all were far above me. That in spite of the majesty of my manliness, I could not, in point of fact, compare with these characters of the gender sex. And my shame, forsooth, then, knew no bounds. while regret, on the other hand, was of no avail, as there was not even a remote possibility of a day of remedy. On this very day, it was that I became desirous to compile, in connected form, for publication throughout the world, with a view to universal information, how that I bear in exorable and manifold retribution, inasmuch as what time, by the sustenance of the benevolence of heaven, and the virtue of my ancestors, my apparel was rich and fine, and as what days my fare was savory and sumptuous. I disregarded the bounty of education and nurture of father and mother, and paid no heed to the virtue of precept and injunction of teachers and friends, with the result that I incurred the punishment of failure recently in the least trifle, and the reckless waste of half my lifetime. There have been meanwhile, generation after generation, those in the inner chambers, the whole mass of whom could not, on any account, be, through my influence, allowed to fall into extinction, in order that I, unfilial as I have been, may have the means to screen my own shortcomings. Hence it is that the hatchet shed with bamboo mat windows, the bed of tow and the stuff of brick, which are at present my share, are not sufficient to deter me from carrying out the fixed purpose of my mind. And could I, furthermore, confront the morning breeze, the evening moon, the willows by the steps, and the flowers in the courtyard, methinks these would moisten to greater degree my mortal pen with ink. But though I lack culture and erudition, what harm is there, however, in employing fiction and unrecondite language to give utterance to the merits of these characters? And were I also able to induce the image of the inner chamber to understand and diffuse them, could I besides break the weariness of even so much as a single moment? Or could I open the eyes of my contemporaries, will it not forsooth prove a boon? This consideration has led to the usage of such name as Jia Yu Cun and other similar appellations. More than any in these pages have been employed such words as dreams and visions, but these dreams constitute the main argument of this work, and combine, furthermore, the design of giving a word of warning to my readers. Reader, can you suggest whence the story begins? The narration may border on the limits of incoherency and triviality, but it possesses considerable zest. But to begin, the Empress Niu Wo, the goddess of works, in fashioning blocks of stones for the repair of the heavens, prepared at the Dahuang Hills and Wuji Cave 36,501 blocks of rough stone, each 12 zhang in height and 24 zhang square. Of these stones, the Empress Wu only used 36,500. So that one single block remained over and above, without being turned to any account. This was cast down the Qinggeng Peak. This stone, strange to say, after having undergone a process of refinement, attained a nature of efficiency, and could, by its innate powers, set itself into motion, and was able to expand and to contract. When it became aware that the whole number of blocks had been made use of to repair the heavens, that it alone had been destitute of the necessary properties, and had been unfit to attain selection, it forthwith felt within itself vexation and shame, and day and night it gave way to anguish and sorrow. One day, while it lamented its lot, it suddenly caught sight, at a great distance, of a Buddhist monks and of a Taoist priest coming towards that direction. Their appearance was uncommon, their easy manner remarkable. When they drew near this Qinggeng Peak, they sat on the ground to rest and began to converse. But on noticing the block, newly polished and brilliantly clear, which had moreover contracted in dimensions and become no larger than the pendant of a fan, they were greatly filled with admiration. Buddhist priest picked it up and laid it in the palm of his hand. "Your appearance," he said laughingly, "may well declare you to be a supernatural object. But as you lack any inherent quality, it is necessary to inscribe a few characters on you, so that every one who shall see you may at once recognize you to be a remarkable thing. And subsequently, when you will be taken into...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.